better about the damage this can do to the morale of soldiers who are fighting, especially when the service chief has failed woefully. You know, if you watch for the last 1 year, the opposition, especially the CUPP and even the PDP, have not focused much attention on the service chief, because we believe that they need concentration. They don't need to be dragged into being, in obsession with political parties and so on and so forth. But we have waited for 5 good years. We're not fools. The money that they are spending is not their money. They're not the one making it. It's Nigerians that are paying the money. What is governance? It's a contract between the people who elect and the person that is elected. And that is why the primary responsibility of governance under Section 14 is just basic protection of lives and property. That is what you are paid to do. And you need to understand, people are paying you. You're not doing them a favor. They are doing you a favor because they give you money for everything you need. So that is why we say that the service chiefs who were hired by the president, that if the president have refused to exercise his right of hire and fire, are we going to be waiting for the president while blood is flowing from Southern Kaduna, blood is flowing from Okene Expressway, flowing from Zamfara, flowing from Katsina, soldiers are being slaughtered? Are you not watching the videos that soldiers are saying, even to be fed, they are not being fed well? These are things that should raise concern. And some of them are being arrested. It's not about arresting soldiers who are making Facebook comments. It's about the commanding chief knowing that the people he has hired for this job has betrayed his trust and are risking the safety of not just our democracy, but our security. And so why is the trillions of naira that have been budgeted for the service chief? And why do you as a commander-in-chief keep people who for 5 good years have presided and led the army that have been unable to record huge success in terms of banditry, in terms of farmers' headers class, in terms of Boko Haram, and we're losing soldiers who are complaining that they don't have the right equipment? And that's what we're asking, not just only to sack and remove them. There will be a probe. This money does not belong to them. We need to find out for every kobo that was given to them in the last 5 years, what was it used for? So because of that, we decided to take the legal part. We're not going to say we're mobilizing people against the Abian police. No, so they don't accuse us of treason. That's why we have gone to the Federal High Court to ask them whether army officers or armed men who have been in the service for more than 60 years and have put in more than 35 years can continue to call themselves officers of the armed forces, and whether they can continue to be in office, and whether the president can extend their tenure. And that's why we're asking the court that if he agrees with us to sack this service chief and stop the president from extending those tenures. That is on one part. But there must be consequences for people who fail to discharge duties that are being paid for. This is a constitutional democracy. And I keep repeating, it is not a favor. Because you are being paid. And that is not what, there must be a forensic audit to find out why is the soldiers complaining. Never in the history of our armed forces, even under Obasanjo, under Yar'Adua, under Jonathan, have soldiers started making Facebook videos complaining. It means that all channels of communications have proved ineffective to their complaint. That is why they know the consequences of making those videos, but they still went ahead to make it because there's no option for them. We need to stand with those, our brothers and sisters, that are doing us a great favor by protecting us, by leaving their families to fight in the bush. The least that citizens can do is to demand that they should be treated very well, and that those issues are addressed by the commander-in-chief, because all our safeties are involved. And that is why we are saying that the court should help us sack this man. Because how do you continue to say you are a leader in the army when your soldiers are complaining about equipment, about allowance? Look at the officer who made a video about the Boko Haram was able to overrun them because they don't have all the equipment that was redeployed. Why will you do that instead of dealing with people who could not provide them those equipment? So we need to know what has happened to those money. And we're talking about monies that are rolling in trillions. How did the ones who went to Katsina and get killed, or how did it happen? Was there no air support? Is it that these people are not coordinating very well? Or they're just giving us media propaganda? And that's why we're demanding those answers. That's why we're wanting the commander-in-chief to do the needful. But since he has failed to do the needful, as citizens, we owe ourselves and our brothers in the fighting front a duty to use the part of the constitutional, the part provided by constitutional governance, which is going to court, to ask the court to sack this man from office. We believe the president should not allow us to go all the way for this. He should just do the needful and relieve them of their duty and bring people who can bring in new ideas. If after 5 years, almost 22 states are under the firm control, part of it, by bandit, Boko Haram and other violent crimes, what are you still doing? Even when your people are resigning, they have lost confidence in you, you are supposed to quit. Are you getting me? People are being retired day by day and their seniors are still there. Had it been that fantastic war, It's different. And that's why it's taking us time to talk about this. If you want the CVP, this is the first time, because we believe that the armed forces require stability. But in respecting that stability, things has gone south. And because things has gone bad, we now owe ourselves a duty to demand for accountability, because they have been paid from taxpayers' fund. And since the commanding chief has failed to do his job, we as citizens have to do that for our people. So now that we're taking that stage today, the next stage is that we also have to keep putting pressure on the commander in chief. If you can't do this job, you get out. If you can't do this job, you get out. If you can't do this job, you get out. Because this job is not a favor. You ask for it, desperately ask for it, for more than four good times. They gave it to you. The way he's running, is he running like somebody who has asked for this power for four good times? And then you go and relax, whatever you like, you come out and sit there where you're treated, you do whatever you like. You're supposed to be responsive and very responsible. Look at the level of corruption that have weighed down on the government. The revelations is so shocking. The corruption has become so childish. Why? Because the commander-in-chief is somewhere behaving like he doesn't care. They are now disrespecting him. People that he has hired to help him govern are disrespecting him, and they are looting the treasury of him. And they are attacking on the key three things that brought him to power. On corruption, they have made sure that they have used corruption to weigh down his government. The same people he hired, and he's still sitting there. On issue of security, they have made sure they have supported that people are being killed left, right, and center in all parts. Look at what's happening in Southern Kaduna. What's his name? RFID. And issues of killing, rape, and destruction. You want to reduce it to make sure that it is a clash and a prison. What kind of nonsense talk is that? And these men and women are being raped and killed every night. All they do is to impose coffee. What nonsense coffee is that? Does it solve the problem? And then you go to the issue of economy, which is one of the issues that brought him. What did he do to the economy? He raped the economy front and back and then sank it immediately, crashed it. Today, look at the rate of the dollar. Do you know what is the exchange rate this morning? It's 480. It's heading to 500. That is the reality on the ground. So if we have borrowed almost over 50 trillion in a very short period of time, what is the impact on the economy? On small scale businesses that are supposed to jump at the economy. The monies are being filtered away. And that was why we objected to the last one, the $22.7 billion. But the people in the parliament who are behaving, especially the leadership, like we used to say, like they are political hallelujah people, approved it without asking questions. And part of that money will be used to repay NTA, almost over 200 billion naira. In a time when they say they don't have one. In a time when soldiers say they don't have equipment to fight in Katsina, in Zamfara, in all parts of the country. This waste, this monumental waste, is still being committed every day. People in every agency who approve money to take care of themselves, which is a new thing. Everybody wants to take care of themselves. They say they will first take care of themselves before the taxpayers. But at the end of the day, they have increased VAT, they have increased the stamp duty, they have even got to a ridiculous one of 6 or 5% on tenancy agreement. So even with all this is happening, they are taxing the citizens more, they are increasing stamp duty, they are increasing all sorts of, and they want to add all sorts of charges. The question is, with all this increment and all this wealth, and failing increase, how has it reflected on the country's saving and economy? Has it stabilized it? No, it has not. What about the borrowing? You see the billions of dollars from IMF, from AFDA, from Chinese banks, from German banks. What has it shown? So it's not a question of money. The president has gotten a lot of money, either by borrowing or by taxing the citizens today. There's a lot he has taken. But why has that not shown on his work? Because he's so incompetent not to manage the people who he has hired to do the job. So they are frittering the money away. That is why people can pay themselves 2 billion, 3 billion to take care of themselves in a government that the man say his selling point is fighting corruption. Remember, the main thing here, had it been it is a government of Mobutu Sese Seko, or India, it's a different thing. But this is the government of a Buhari that said that, oh, there is zero tolerance to corruption. Now the men are telling him that corruption is institution, is way of life under him. All the looters we know are all around looting it. What has he done to them? Has he responded proactively? No. But the first thing he did after over 2-3 months of not coming out of that sort is to enter the plane, fueled by taxpayers' money, to go to Mali to make peace. When in Katsina, the soldiers were being killed. People are being killed left, right, and center. He has not made peace in Southern Kaduna. His major responsibility under Section 14 of the Constitution, protection of lives and property. This is not about, I don't hate him. Opposition doesn't hate him. Nobody hates him. But is this what the people voted for? Is this what the people want? Why are they being slaughtered and you want to go to Mali to make peace for Malians? And what is the peace you're making in Mali? in a situation whereby a man ripped himself into office, Baba Kaite, the opposition leader, was kidnapped by jihadist group, held even up to today. And the fraudulent election was held, and the man said he won. Why the jihadist was holding the major presidential candidate, Sisi? He went there to go and make it. But the citizens of Mali have woken up and said enough is enough. What of Southern Kaduna? What of Zamfara? What of Katsina? What of Benue? What of the highways here towards Ogun and Oyo? Killing and destruction is going out of hand. And the killers have so much audacity, strong weapons. And soldiers are complaining they are not being fed. And some are resigning. And you don't see anything wrong with this. You think this is about politics or religious or cyber issue? No, it is not. No, it is not. So we must continue to demand. Nobody should be intimidated about that. It doesn't matter. They can do all sorts of abracadabra. They even want to divide the opposition. It does not matter. Even if it is one voice, we must continue to do the right thing and speak up. And that is why we came here to say, now we are taking a legal action because that is the right thing to do. Now we continue the engagement with the Human Mobilization Department led by Kenneth Udeze. He's doing. We are talking to civil society group. Let us have a consensus to demand for more from government. We're not going to commit treason or felony or whatever you call it. That's why we're taking the civil approach of demanding for answers, taking illegal actions, doing it the right way, hoping that God will touch his conscience to understand that 5 years ago, this was not the man Nigeria wanted. That he went low, he can sit up and then activate this process and it will work. That's what this is all about.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
They train you for 6 years.